this is the Library Club. And it's a place where things have happened since the 1800s, as I understand.
The battery is still a major.
Theater, speakers, music. Theater, speakers, music. And there is another beautiful big painting.
Oh, yeah.
And, of course, the audience.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's play. My name is Rachel Courey, sponsored by Calvin College Release Club, the Calvin College History Department, the Hilding Children's of Conflict, Peace Means Organization from Grand Valley State University, as well as the Middle East Education Project of IGE. Today's play is going to run for 80 minutes long. It is based off the famous activist Rachel Courey. The original play is directed by Alan Rickman and Catherine Viner. And today's star is going to be Ashley Mallory, and the director is Joshua Kirstein. The first act of this 80-minute play is going to be set in Olympia, Washington, Rachel Corey's hometown, and the second act of this play is from January through March in Rafah, Gaza. Please remember that today's play, though it is free, there is a suggested donation for this play, and a basket will be put through at the end of this play, as well as with a question and answer time with the director and the main actress, Ashley and Josh. Also, please do remember that there are two exits. In case of a fire emergency, there are two exits behind you, two exits at the side. I will remind you as well to please turn off your cell phones and silence them for the duration of this play. Please enjoy.
It's always where to start the story. That is the first question. Trying to find a beginning. Trying to impose order on this crazy, psychotic, fast-forward merry-go-round. Trying to impose order, that's like the first step toward ending up in a park somewhere, painted blue, singing, row, row, row your boat to an audience of saggy-lipped junkies or business people munching oat bran muffins in the park. That is how the story ends, my friends. So if you're interested in the logic, or the sequence of things, or the great crescendo of suspense right up to a great shocker of an ending, well, you must be getting back to your video games. Or your amassing wealth. Leave those meaningless details to the poets. Photographers. And the truth is, they're all meaningless details, my friends. Thank you. one that I can remember now seems like it would be a really good rule for life. Everyone must feel safe. Safe to be themselves. Physically safe. Safe to say what they think. Just safe. That's the best rule that I can think of. I'm in middle school now, so I guess I've grown up a little. It's all relative anyway, you know? 9 years is as long as 40 years, depending on how long you've lived. I stole that from my dad, but you know, sometimes I think my dad's the wisest person in the whole world. You understand that none of this is even actually true, though, because what I wrote today is true, but then you'll read it by tomorrow or the next day, and by then my whole life will be different. Is that how life is? A new draft for each day? A new view for each hour? When I was in fifth grade, we had this list of questions for a yearbook, and one of them was, what do you want to be when you grow up? So everyone wrote something like doctor, astronaut, Spider-Man. And then you turn the page, and there was my 5-paragraph manifesto on the million things that I wanted to be, from wandering poet to first woman president. And yeah, that's like really cute when you're in fifth grade. But 10 years later, and I'm a junior in college, and I still don't have the conviction to cross Spider-Man off my list. yeah, you can imagine, it gets a little nerve-wracking. I'm building this world myself. And I am gonna put new hats on everybody one by one before I go out. So old and wrinkled that I have to lift a great big flaps of my eyebrows off my cheeks in order to see. Oh, before I go out, I'm gonna have people in tutus, and cops in sombreros, business people with Viking hats, and priests with panties on their heads. See, in this world, everyone's going to have these speakers attached to their chest that pour out music so you can tell from a distance what mood they're in. And no one is going to be too chicken to just get naked when the rain comes. In this world, first ladies will carry handcuffs, and bullwhips, and presidents will wear metal collars, big metal collars with tight leashes. Okay. I'm Rachel. Sometimes I wear ripped blue jeans. Sometimes I wear pleats. Sometimes I just take off all my clothes and I swim naked at the beach. I don't believe in fate, but my astrological sign is Aries, the ram, and my sign on the Chinese zodiac is the sheep, and Rachel means sheep. I got a fire in my belly, and that fire used to be so big and blazing and loud that I couldn't hear anybody else over it, so I talked a lot, didn't listen too much. And then I went to middle school, where you gotta be cool and strong, gotta be tough. So I tried real hard to be cool. And then luckily, I won a free trip to Russia, and I saw another country for the first time. And in the streets, and in the alleyways, it was like this obstacle course of garbage and mud and graffiti. Everything was dirty. Everything had this layer of coal dust on it. And they always said to us, oh, how do you like our dirty city? But it was so pretty. With the little lights in the windows and this red dust light that just settled over all of the buildings. It was flawed. It was dirty. It was broken, and it was gorgeous. across the Pacific Ocean to Olympia, Washington, USA. Some things seemed a little weird. Disconcerting. But I was awake in Russia. I was awake for the first time, with bug eyes and a grin. Finally told me to stay. Or maybe going to school in my hometown, it really was just the path of least resistance. Maybe going to the Evergreen State College was just the best way to be different from my economic major high achiever khaki high heel wearing Yale corporate brother and sister. I don't know. I don't know why I stayed. But one day, I knew. I had to. And that was the same day that I decided to be an artist and to be a writer. And I didn't give a shit if I was mediocre. I didn't give a shit if I starved to death. I didn't give a shit if my whole damn high school turned and pointed and laughed in my face because I was finally awake. Forever. I just heard from Chris in Gaza. Being invited there. I need to go. I've been organizing in Olympia for a little over a year now on these anti-war and global justice issues. And it started to feel like this work is missing the connection to the people who are impacted by US foreign policy. I just think we have a right to be critical of government policy, of any government policy, but particularly the policies which we are funding. And yes, I feel pretty isolated from the world. I've lived in Olympia my whole life, and my activism has been extremely tied to Olympia, but I have this need to go to a place and to meet the people who are on the other end of the tax money that's going to fund the US military. So trying to be local, but also respectful of the local, that's a really big part of my ethic, I guess. I didn't intend to become so deeply involved in activism this year. I'm not even sure what compelled me to sign up for local knowledge class because there's this huge degree of community involvement. I'm phobic of community. I mean, I'm scared of people, particularly people in the greater Olympia area. It's another decades ago, a place where hippie kids come after touring with their jam bands. And I've been here my whole life. Almost everyone I know and have known from Olympia came from somewhere else. So I don't think it was my intention to be of any particular use to these communities we were studying. No, I was just looking for these curious facts to flesh out an authentic setting. Trivia. Like, when I worked at Mount Rainier, we followed this woman into the woods. Now, she had become part owl. Her job was to entice them out. Ooh. Ooh, ooh. Ooh, ooh. Our job was to just, oh, carry the light nice. Oh. But somehow, after years of doing this spotted owl survey, this woman's larynx changed. I mean, she croaked in a language that was articulated somewhere deeper than tonsils. Her tongue probably changed shape. And we followed her on the northwest side of the mountain all day. And saw no owls. And no owls looked back at her. But I think about how many of us doing any kind of progressive work in this region, we swim beneath the surface. Combing for what was here before, taking inventory of what is now. And there's the chance you could be changed by what you're looking for. I mean, your tongue could change shape like the woman at Rainier. Studying the history of this area roots me, because we've certainly waded in the same water and wandered on the same beaches as very brave people. And that makes bravery seem more possible. We can look at that history and decide, okay, which side do we want to be on? We are not outside. Right now, as far as I can tell, over 1,000 people are being held somewhere in the US, and it's unclear why. They arrest the dirty bomber, someone apparently in the very early stages of planning an attack on the US. And this is big news. But what does this say about the 1,000 other people being held somewhere? That they weren't in the early stages planning anything. Looking for where I fit into all this, forcing out into the community. You come to take for granted where you belong in a community, because if you have this overactive fantasy life, you can make up just enough unrelated pieces of trivia to hold up your coffee table conversation and never have to think about anything disturbing or demanding of action. Still pretty shell-shocked by this semester. I spoke to a room of about 40 international students. I helped in the planning of 2 conferences, facilitated meetings, danced down the street with people ages 7 to 70 dressed as doves. I spent a lot of time with the homeless group. I went with them to city council. I went with them to the community conversation. I slept out overnight on May Day. Who is this person? How did I get here? Hey, Mom, can you email to me a list of people you think it might be good to contact if I get in trouble? Not planning on it. Just friends, family, who you think might contact your local congressman. Also maybe people who might be interested in getting information, or at least knowing that I'm going. I'm gonna give the Olympian your number. Please think about your language when you talk to them. I think it was really smart. You were wary of using the word terrorism. And if you talk about the cycle of violence or an eye for an eye, you could actually be perpetuating the idea that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is a balanced conflict, when actually it's the fourth most powerful military in the world against a largely unarmed group of people. So, you know, these are the kind of things that you need to think about before you talk to reporters. Okay. I will talk to you tonight.
We have a really involved mother. Sometimes she's just so overly involved. It means we have to kick and claw just to get some autonomy. Scream until we get some space to grow in. Also means we let her take care of things we're completely capable of taking care of by herself. I think of my mom as being extremely moralistic. Not in a bad way. There were things that none of us did. Lying, teasing, stealing, just being mean to people. She often wondered, though, if we'd be healthier, better children if she had taken us to church. I think that was a scare tactic. But I know this woman who's decided not to assign her baby a gender until it chooses its own. I think that's kind of nuts, but I guess my mom had the same sort of attitude towards my spirituality. She was determined I would define it for myself. I could write a family history just based on the discoveries I've made over the years. Drawers, cabinets, unfinished baby books, duplicate containers of oregano from houses that we moved out of, placemats that defeated cranberry juice and oyster stew and candle wax, I'm heartbroken when I search my mother's drawers. Heartbroken at the way she arranges her jewelry. I know how she returns each earring to its own tiny little box when she's done. I'm just heartbroken at the thought of her standing there in her big bra, her pantyhose stretched over her underwear, rubbing on lipstick, dabbing pink powder into her pores until it agrees to hang on. My mother ages and puts on makeup, slides bracelets across her wrist where the skin is loose. Sometimes she's up there like this Macy's parade balloon. Like, she's so big, she just looms over everything. I scare you, Mom. I'm sorry I scare you. But I want to write. And I want to see. And what would I write about if I stayed inside the doll's house, this flower world I grew up in? You gave me a potential. I love you, but I'm growing out of what you gave me. I'm saving it inside me, and I'm growing outwards. Let me fight my monsters. You made me. You made me. Reading political economy in the green lawn chair.
I danced around magnetic fields and mowed the lawn. We walked to school together in the morning. And finally, it rained. Colin wanted me to walk faster. Always wanted me to walk faster. Well, I just wanted to trudge and identify the ferns. I woke up early one morning with errands to run and decided I would bump into Colin and his new hoochie-ass girlfriend. I shaved my armpits. I put on a tight shirt. I got in the little boys section of the Salvation Army. Smeared on my chest. Fun life, I say. Fun life.
This is the library club, and it's a place where things have happened since the 1800s, as I understand. Theater, speakers, music, theater, speakers, music.
And what would I write about if I stayed inside the doll's house, this flower world I grew up in? You gave me a potential. I love you, but I'm growing out of what you gave me. I'm saving it inside me, and I'm growing outwards. Let me fight my monsters. You made me. You made me.
I danced around magnetic fields and mowed the lawn. We walked to school together in the morning. And finally, it rained. Colin wanted me to walk faster. Always wanted me to walk faster. Well, I just wanted to trudge and identify the ferns. I woke up early one morning with errands to run and decided I would bump into Colin and his new hoochie-ass girlfriend. I shaved my armpits, I put on a tight shirt, I got in the little boys section of the Salvation Army. Smeared on my chapstick. Fun life, I say. Fun life. I imagine I'm in a Mountain Dew commercial. And I'm on the beach with a bevy of my sinewy friends who are always dancing. I meander through downtown. Oh, they're here somewhere together. Most likely ensnared in a shadow. But they'll drop the spoons in that strawberry milkshake when I slide past. Free the bird. Fun life. 2 p.m. Sam. Okay, they're not at the coffee shop. Or the grocery store. The bridge. The magazine stand. Drive to school. Embarrassed at myself. Yes, girlfriend. I stick my hips out in the sun, and I make six guns at him. He turns back to me, he makes six guns back at me. Oh, this town is not big enough for the two of us. He just shook his head, laughed at me. It's so easy to make that journey. You'll know when the time comes. You'll fall in love with someone who's perpetually leaving you. Someone who beats you at Scrabble, talks with big words, tells all stories as if they're blues songs. You'll memorize the features of someone
whose eyes are perpetually bored, whose lips are perpetually amused. Eventually, I convince Colin to quit drowning out my life. The topography of Colin's life consisted of emergency adrenaline shots, jail, sometimes near-death experiences. Topography of my life was making up a name for a neighborhood cat, a new poem, the gossip with my friends. His life was skyscrapers. And my life took place on a much smaller scale. But that's done now. We are proportionate. Wednesday, I walked down into the forest, down the path to the little wooden bridge over the creek. And I stood on the bridge, and I noticed that there was this log laying across the stream that someone had lined these little rocks along, like multicolored frogs across this log. So I took off my shoes and my socks, set them down on the edge of the bridge. Then I jumped onto the bank. Climbed onto that log. And I walked across it. Carefully, nimbly. Only one of the rocks fell in the water. And I squatted in the pebbles. I fished out these interesting rocks for myself. I cleaned them. And I held them. In my pocket. And like Huck Finn, with my jeans rolled up and my back to the bridge, my two empty little brown boots, I sang to the forest. I hummed, I made up waltzes, I belted out Russian drinking songs, I opened my mouth wide and sang.
25th, 2003. Very little trouble at the airport. My tight jeans and cropped bunny hair sweater seem to have made all the difference. Of course, the use of my Israeli friend's address. The only question was, where did you meet her? The woman behind the glass appeared not to notice my shaking hands. I took a shared taxi to Jerusalem and realized that the Holy Land is full of rocks. It seems like driving you could just fall right off these hills. My introduction to curfew was just gentle. A rush outside in the midst of our training to buy lunch before the shops close in Beit Sahur. Shawarma and our falafel, the noise had become the bleat of military jeep horns, the squeal of a car, shouting over a bullhorn, border police, or IDF, I don't remember which. Palestinian self-determination is the fear of being or sounding anti-Semitic. The people of Israel are suffering. Jewish people have a long history of oppression, and we still have some responsibility for that. But I think it's important that we begin to draw that firm distinction between the policies of Israel as a state and Jewish people. I think that's kind of a no-brainer, but a really strong pressure to conflate the two. So I try to ask myself, well, whose interest does that serve to identify Israeli policy with all Jewish people? These are ideas I'm having, and they're evolving, and I'm really new to Israel-Palestine. So I don't always know the political implications of my words. Notes from training. When talking, no hearsay. Call hospitals and official sources, use quotes, don't appear to judge rightness or wrongness. Nonviolence. Don't touch those who are confronting, don't run, carry nothing that could be used as a weapon, and no self-initiating actions. The reality of curfew, of checkpoints.
I'm sort of embarrassed about how long it takes me to realize in my gut people live like this. At 10 p.m., I travel to Rafa. Jahan, that we have soldiers at bus station. Bomb market in Gaza City. Children grab my ass, throw garbage at my head, scream, "What's your name?" February 1st, we started into the field, 500 nationals plus Jahan. Jenny spoke over the loudspeaker saying, "Do not shoot, we are unarmed civilians!" Naming the countries we came from and letting the IDF know that our intention was to get that man's body. The first response from the IDF was shouting, "Go back!" And then they shot about 20 meters in front of us. As we continued in the direction of the body, the shots shifted, some coming 2 to 4 meters in front of us, and these two high-pitched whistling sounds above our heads. So we stopped! And Jenny requested to speak to the commanding officer! A white truck with a blue light rolled up next to us. The person in the truck spoke over the loudspeaker saying, "You'll get the body later." The white truck cruised away. And then a tank and a bulldozer began moving towards us from the IDF side of the checkpoint. They created this mound of dirt between us and the olive grove. Smoke blew. They created this mound of dirt and shot repeatedly into it. This is poorly drawn picture of the dead body that we just carried. His hand was poised off the stretcher as if he was doing the crawl, throwing a baseball.
Dr. Smear's garden. Fig tree. Small buds. White plastic lawn chair. Blanket. Drying on the line. I went into the kitchen and I stayed for 2 hours. The tank stayed too, so no work, no school. Soldier came with a sledgehammer. Tank started firing. Dr. Samir says,
but it's my world, it's my home,
it's my home.
Not always right,
not always right,
but not all wrong,
not all wrong.
And I love it,
I love it.
So I'm gonna stay,
I'm gonna stay,
make it better,
make it better
every day.
Winked at me before I flicked my eyes back to the road, and Kelly said,
"Whoa, we got the car,"
and I I said, yeah, I've got the gas card too. And then Jim said, oh, sorry, your mom's dead. And I was like, it's fine, Jim, you know, we all deal with loss throughout our lives, right? And he said, yeah, don't push it. And then we sang Beatles songs all the way to Oregon and goodbye, Ruby Tuesday, 728 times in California and the Devonport. And all the voices joined in on Bobby and Phil. Strange men are offering me peas, so I need to eat, I think. Rachel Courey, an American peace activist, was killed by an IDF bulldozer while trying to defend a Palestinian's home from being demolished by Israeli settlers.
I'm here because I care. I'm here because children everywhere are suffering and because 40,000 people die each day from hunger. I'm here because those people are mostly children. We have got to understand that the poor are all around us and we're ignoring them. We have got to understand that these deaths are preventable. We have got to understand that people in third world countries think and care and smile and cry just like us. We have got to understand that they dream our dreams and we dream theirs. We have got to understand that they are us, we are them. My dream is to stop hunger by the year 2000. My dream is to give the poor a chance. My dream is to save the 40,000 people who die each day. My dream can and will come true if we all look into the future and see the light that shines there. If we ignore hunger, that light will go out. If we all help and work together, it will grow and burn free with the potential of tomorrow.
Sponsors for this event. As you've already seen, one of the part of the traditions of Calvin College is to invite a lot of the actors and the directors and musicians to come up and have a question and answer time and as well share their own stories about how they got involved in this play or in their music. While this time they will be sharing as well about what their donations will be going to today. There will be donation baskets that will be passed around. Please put as little or as much as you guys feel. But the donations will be going to Hope Theater, which will be something that this play is sponsoring and donating to, as well as for their own endeavors. And so without further ado, I'd like to introduce the director, Josh Grossman, and Ashley Mallory.
And we are taking donations to cover the cost of the actors' travel to Grand Rapids. They'll also be in Saginaw and Kalamazoo. And royalties for the play, and they're not asking for any money for themselves or their time. Everything extra will go to the Freedom Theater in Janine on the West Bank. It's all either going to theater or their efforts. There's no profit making.
They'll turn off the lights in a second so I can see you. Hi, I'm Josh Pearlstein, this is Ashley. You know her. So I just want to talk for a little bit about what brought us here and what hopefully we can bring away from coming out to Michigan. I have to just on a personal note say that it's great to be here because I was born in Michigan and I haven't been back in 50 years. Nope. So it's a little bit of a homecoming for me. How many of you have traveled to the West Bank or to Gaza? Just a few. So I'm hoping that tonight will be a little bit, that not only Rachel's words obviously were informative and illuminating, but that it encourages you to look more deeply into the whole situation. While I grew up as a Jew in Detroit and then in Connecticut and Massachusetts, my journey to Palestine was a little bit more, it was kind of convoluted, I suppose. My mom was the president of Hadassah, and she administered the local synagogue, and I had a bar mitzvah, I did the whole thing. But in 2007, I was at a party in Amherst, Mass, where I live, and I met a man who introduced me to his friend Giuliano Meracamis, who was running a theater at the time in the West Bank called the Freedom Theater. The Freedom Theater was started to help refugee children find an alternative to violence by giving them an opportunity to create music or art or dance. And the theater, I'll just try to give you you can look it up online. I'll give you the Spark Notes version. So, in 1991, during the first Intifada, Giuliano's mother, a woman named Arna Meracamis, went. She was an Israeli Jew. She was married to a Christian Palestinian, and they lived in Israel. She was a member of the Haganah, the resistance during the leading up to the Israeli War of Independence, called other things by other people. And eventually, in the first Intifada, she went to the refugee camp in Jenin, and she started crayons and paper, and she started drawing with the children on the street. And these local women said, "What are you doing?" And she said, "Well, your children must be suffering terribly, so I thought that they should have art, because, their world is falling apart around them, and my people are doing it to them, so I thought that maybe I should do something about that." So she slowly won these women over to the point that one of the women, and her first name is going to escape me, so we'll call her Mrs., but Zubaydi was her last name. But she donated her house to the creation of what would become the first theater in the refugee camp called the Stone Theater. And it lasted for about 3, 4, maybe 5 years. All the young children in the camp would come and they'd do plays based on Palestinian culture. And one of them was a man named Zachariah Zubaydi, and you may or may not have heard of him, and he'll come up into the story a little bit later. But in 1996, Arna got cancer and died. Giuliano, who was her son, who was one of the leading actors in Israel at the time, would come back and forth to the camp and lead acting workshops and do other sorts of things while he was seeking his professional acting career in Israel. In 2000, the Second Intifada started, and many of the young men who had been involved in the theater as 13 or 14-year-olds soon became involved in the militias in Jenin, the most famous one known as the Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigade, which was in response to the visit at the Al-Aqsa Mosque by Ariel Sharon. And so Jenin became this hotbed for, I'm sure I'm talking to you, a lot of you maybe already know this, so. But it became the center for not only suicide bombings coming out of Jenin, but then eventually in 2002, the Israeli army came in to what was called the Battle of Jenin, and many of the young men who were in this, as I said, this original theater group, as actors, died. Many of them died. And Giuliano went back in 2002 to find out what happened to these young men that he had worked with as a theater director and as a teacher. And he brought his film camera with him, and he went to seek them all out and found out at that moment that they had either died in the militias, in the fighting, or actually his sweetest and most lovely young actor had actually been a suicide bomber in Tel Aviv. And he documented this in a movie called Arna's Children, which, and a lot of people respond to that notion of like, well, what kind of a, how much good did the theater actually do if eventually these people went on to, you know, fight anyway or become suicide bombers? And Giuliano would always respond, well, that's how bad it is, because these were decent, wonderful young men who at a certain point in their life saw no other possibility other than to resort to violence. In about 2003, Zakaria Zubayadi, whose mom I mentioned before, had become the leader of the Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigade, and as a result of which became also Israel's number one most wanted assassination target. And they targeted him, the military of Israel targeted him for assassination. He then went on the run for about 3 years in hiding, mostly throughout the camp. At one point, when the military came in and tried to find him and couldn't, they bulldozed his house where he lived with his mothers and brothers, and they killed his mother and his brother as a result of not being able to find him. So 3 years after being in hiding, in 2006, Zakaria had this sort of epiphany that the only way to save his people was going to be by bringing back the Stone Theater, by recreating the opportunity for the children there to have art, that people must engage in what would become called the cultural intifada, that art as an act of resistance to the occupation was the only way, because by fighting, he felt that the young men in particular, but when young women too, were destroying their souls, not just being physically, obviously, killed, but that their souls and their spirits were being killed as well. And so he went back to Giuliano and he said, I need you to come back to Jenin. I know you have a very lucrative career as an actor, but I need you to come back to Jenin and I need you to restart the theater. And Giuliano did, and in 2006 he came back and started the theater along with Zakaria, sort of in hiding, and then Jonathan Stanzik, an Israeli Swede, who came back to start the theater as well. So the three of them started the theater. Zakaria by this time had gotten a amnesty along with many, many, many other fighters. The Israeli government said, you put your guns down, we'll stop trying to kill you. Okay, so that was sort of the peace agreement that they had at that time. So Giuliano came back, started the theater, and he essentially said to Zakaria, I'll come back and I'll do this theater, but you must agree to understand that I feel that the occupation doesn't just exist from the Israelis, that there's other forms of occupation that are happening as well, that the treatment of women and the treatment of children in the Jenin refugee camp has to be addressed and has to be dealt with. The Palestinian men have to treat their wives better and have to treat their children better, that we suffer from a forms of internal oppression, and I don't want to start a theater that just becomes a theater of blame, that just points fingers at Israel, because that's not a way to resurrect, at least according to Giuliano, that's not the way to liberate your soul. The way to liberate your soul is through acts of artistic, you know, creation. So he wanted to make sure that that was clear. So he became a very controversial figure, I don't know if you can imagine, within the camp as well. because he was now not only antagonizing the Israelis, but he was also antagonizing many of the local people, a very fundamental and conservative Muslim community within the refugee camp itself. The theater was burned down several times. The theater was, Giuliano had many, several death threats. When I was there, the first time I went there, I was in my apartment, which was sort of back behind the theater. It's kind of an amazing thing, because again, without having gone to Palestine, too many of you, but when you go into a refugee camp, this is, you know, 20,000 people living within a square kilometer, all on top of each other, nothing to do, nowhere to go, no movie theaters, no restaurants, nothing to do. And I mean, as a result, the people are very social and hospitable and the most sort of generous people I've ever met in my entire life in terms of what they would do for me. I mean, Rachel has a line about that. You know, it's just astounding how generous. We're not being this way because we're a hotel. We're just, you know, this is what we want to do for you. We just want people to know that we're here and we're human, and that's all we really strive for. So the first time I was there, I was up and I heard this screaming sound, and all of a sudden I opened my door and there was this horde of young girls, and one of them, who turned out to be Giuliano's daughter, was bleeding from the side of her head because the neighbor, who hated Giuliano, had thrown a rock at her because she was playing in the courtyard of the theater and while he was having his supper, so he came out and, you know, threw a brick at her head or something. There was just so much strife and so much of this stuff that went on, and Giuliano so many times had suffered from tremendous threats. He did a very controversial adaptation of Alice in Wonderland called Alice, and it was essentially the story of a young Palestinian woman who decides against her parents' wishes to marry the boy of her dreams as opposed to the boy that they want. And in Palestine at that time, or even now, this is a very, very, very outrageous act. In the Freedom Theater, boys and girls, I had to meet my students out sort of in a dark room away where nobody could see, and they were not allowed to sort of hang out together in public. Boys and girls were not really allowed to do that. So any girl who joined the Freedom Theater as a young actor was truly a revolutionary because of this, not just scorn or shame that most of you would treat your children when they entered the theater, but yeah, like that's normal. But you know, in Palestine, it was basically, you know, death threats and worse. Really, really suffering from tremendous amount. I don't want to go on too long, but a sense that these people were living under tremendous amounts of, just the occupation was only one part of the misery that they have to deal with on a daily basis. So Alice was this very controversial production. Giuliano was in the meantime gaining an international reputation. I don't know if you've heard of these people, but Tony Kushner, a very famous American playwright and screenwriter, has become a supporter. Vanessa Redgrave is a supporter. Maya Angelou is a supporter. Eve Ensler, who wrote The Vagina Monologues, is a supporter. All these people have done a lot of work to raise a significant amount of money for the theater. People like Michael Palin from Monty Python have gone over. Many, many, many people from the Royal Shakespeare Company have gone over to teach, direct, and act with the theater company. Most recently, I don't know, was the movie Omar around here? It was nominated for one of my students from the Freedom Theater was in that movie. He was the second lead in the movie, so had a lot of success there. So there's been a lot of success for these folks. Right after Alice closed, Giuliano was directing a production in Ramallah and was coming back to the theater, and somebody walked up to his car and said, he was driving away from the theater, and they said, "Giuliano, Giuliano," and he stopped the car, and this man walked up and shot him 5 times right before he died, according to the stories that are told in the camp. He was carrying his one-year-old baby on his lap at the time. He was, you know, that's what they do. They, you know, drive with the babies on their laps. My dad used to do that, but whatever. So he was driving with his baby on his lap, and after he had been shot a couple of times, he said to the gunman, "Stop. Stop. Me, not the baby." And the gunman stopped, and he handed the baby to his babysitter, and then, you know, motioned the babysitter to the gunman to continue. And he was shot 3 more times and died within about 45 minutes. They've never solved the murder officially. The people at the Freedom Theater have suffered tremendous amounts of harassment and worse since. Nabil Al-Arey, who is the current artistic director, was arrested for no cause and held in solitary confinement for 2 months. He was just in New York. I just spent a couple of days with him in New York, and he has recovered amazingly and is now leading the theater. They have 5 international touring productions that have, one was recently, I don't know if you remember the, Otto Fugard is this a familiar name? So, great South African playwright who wrote a play called The Island about Nelson Mandela, essentially, and his confinement on Robben's Island. And they toured a production of The Island that was reset in Palestine. And they just toured it and performed at Georgetown University and throughout the New York, the Northeast. And John Connie, one of the original writers, gave it this amazingly splendid endorsement of the project. So the work of Juliana goes on. As I said, the Israeli army has come in several times in the night and arrested many members of the current staff under the guise of investigating the murder. Nabil told me, I mean, it really becomes Kafka-esque. Yes, I'm almost done. So that's essentially the story, and that's what brought us here. And Ashley was a student at my school, and we brought them to the school, and they were able to impact her to the point that she decided that she wanted to do this piece. She will be touring this throughout the United States. I think we have about 20 different states at this point that we're traveling to over the next 6 months to a year. And this is our first really sort of maybe official tour date. I just have to sort of like. She just performed for the chorus on the anniversary of Rachel's death in Olympia. She was asked to go. We had told her about the tour. They said, you know, nobody's ever done the play in Olympia, which in her hometown, would you please come and do it? Of the 250 different Rachels that have been performed this over the last 10 years, I thought it was kind of remarkable. And the one thing I also have to say is that when she did it at our school, when Ash performed it at our school, the Coreys came to the performance, and they sat in the front row. And when she had the piece to her father in the end of the end of the play, when she talks, you know, Papa. Ashley, she said to me before we start, she goes, the Coreys are here. Should I look at him?
What do I do?
Like, they're actually here. I can't just look at somebody else and say, Papa.
Yeah, right? Like, he's sitting right next to him.
So she looked at him, and she delivered that monologue to Craig Corey. And he told us afterwards, and we didn't know, but he said, that was the first time any Rachel has ever talked to me. And he was so moved by Ash's performance, so we were really honored to have the opportunity to go to Olympia. So that's our story and why we're here. So do you have any questions? Yeah.
Well, I'm glad that you mentioned South Africa. I was in South Africa during apartheid, and theater, music, and dance were a very important part of the process that the people of color in South Africa were using to communicate with each other and to motivate people and to organize. And I was privileged to see some of those performances. But it sounds like in Palestine it's much more difficult to get support from the Palestinians themselves for powerful theater pieces that might be used.
Like we can hear.
I project pretty well. This doesn't work anyway. But it's confusing to me and painful to me to hear that it doesn't work well in Palestine, that the people are resistant to this really powerful tool.
Well, the conservative elements, which would exist more in the north of Palestine, in Jenin, is in the north, so it's kind of, I don't know, where the more of the religious fundamental stuff happens. Yeah, there's no singing or dancing. There's no, it's, men are allowed, I mean, I shouldn't say there's none. There's, you know, you go to a wedding and the men are doing the dabka, you know. But yeah, it's very different, but that's what was prevented at the theater itself. Yeah, it is difficult. But there are a lot of people who are devoted to the, I would say, to the resurrection of a lot of Palestinian culture, Mahmoud Darwish's poetry and other people. And certainly in Ramallah and in the South, there's an attempt to create a Palestinian theater. There aren't that many. There's about 6 or 7 theaters throughout the country. So there's no real tradition of that either. Yeah, it's hard.
This is the Library Club. And it's a place where things have happened since the 1800s, as I understand.
The battery is still a major
theater, speakers, music.